Extinction Rebellion, often abbreviated as XR, is an environmental pressure group with the stated aim of using civil disobedience to compel government action on climate change, biodiversity loss, and ecological collapse. The group frequently cites figures like Martin Luther King Jr. and Mahatma Gandhi as influences on their praxis. Extinction Rebellion was founded in 2018, following the IPCC climate change report that outlined how truly fucked we are. The way Wikipedia makes it sound, they surfaced around 2018, but its founders have been activists for many years. Many seem to have met during the Occupy movement, and later went on to form Rising Up, not to be confused with Rise Up, the online communication toolset. Roger Hallam is arguably the most prominent and radical founder, taking part in a variety of struggles over the decade and getting himself arrested several times, as well as being a founding member of Radical Roots. The same people who started Rising Up also started Compassionate Revolution, an organization that had some questionable ideas about praxis.
Cafes that specialise in takeaways have two prices for cold food. If you ask for a takeaway but eat the food inside, you will have deprived government of a small amount of tax, which is a symbolic action.
The ideals of Compassionate Revolution are all reformist in nature. Green New Deal, co-ops, vaguely anti-interventionist foreign policy, that kind of stuff. The same draft manifesto is found on the websites for both Compassionate Revolution and Rising Up. To quote from Extinction Rebellion's FAQ section, Rising Up is the group that set up Extinction Rebellion as a project. Rising Up has been around since 2016 and has run a variety of campaigns. Compassionate Revolution was set up in 2015 to try to build mass civil disobedience through an online platform that could capture people's conditional commitments. I will do this if other people do. The website and company, for reasons of legal convenience, were used to establish Rising Up. Our bank account is in the name of Compassionate Revolution as a result. Compassionate Revolution Limited currently has three directors, Gail Bradbrook, Roger Hallam, and George Barda. Although it is a company limited by shares, which we were advised would be easiest to set up and run, the organization is not for profit and HMRC has therefore agreed we do not have to pay any tax.
Cafes that specialize in takeaways have two prices for cold food. If you ask for a takeaway but eat the food inside, you will have deprived government of a small amount of tax, which is a symbolic action. You can see how much on the board prices. So this cake should have cost £1.20, but I only paid £1. Enjoy yourself, good luck with it, this is just the start. We will provide messages for government and for social media as part of the protest.
Tell me over and over and over and over again, my friend, you don't believe we're on the eve of destruction.
Lacking a solid critique of capitalism's role in the destruction of the environment, Extinction Rebellion are setting themselves up for disappointment. Ecological problems are inherently tied to capitalism. If it were mere bad actors, they wouldn't be so powerful and hard to stop. Capitalists are incentivized to destroy and exploit the environment. Without addressing what incentivized them in the first place, how can you hope to guarantee they won't do it again? Especially if you're not going to disempower them from making the same huge but profitable mistakes. Many might point out that corporations are now attempting to cut down on their emissions. Some of this could be dismissed as overhyped marketing. However, even being charitable and assuming that fossil fuel companies do want to diversify into greener energy sources, this is only possible as a long-term strategy. Something that tends to make investors nervous, as typically they don't provide more immediate large profits. We can see this in action with ExxonMobil. In the 1970s and early 80s, ExxonMobil was actually funding a lot of research into climate change, trying to determine if they would need to diversify their business model. However, in the mid-80s, the price of oil took a sharp dive by roughly 50%, meaning they would have to make several cutbacks to long-term investments. One of them being research into climate change. ExxonMobil are currently being sued for covering up a lot of the research they did into climate change. Energy companies diversifying into green energy is only sustainable if the fossil fuel market remains steady, because as it stands, fossil fuels remain far more profitable. We can also look at BP, who seem quite proud that they produced 765 million litres of biofuel in 2018. This pales in contrast with their increased production of crude oil in 2018, following a recent acquisition of BHP's onshore shale portfolio, which by my estimates totaled 588,251,900 litres a day. In order to retain their massive profits, these companies still need to produce energy through fossil fuels. This means that a sustainable future for our planet is not compatible with capitalism. Extinction Rebellion have built an image around being single issue for good PR. The slogan Beyond Politics is touted by many members as something to unify the movement.
We're not ideological. There may be people in Extinction Rebellion that think a different version of capitalism is cool, or they like this form or that form. It's not down to us to say we want this kind of system or not that one or whatever. This one's not working for us.
Despite seeing statements and actions from some of their chapters that suggest they are taking on board critiques of capitalism, I remain very sceptical of XR's politics. I think the limits of their capability to critique capitalism is set out in Compassionate Revolution's draft manifesto. Left-leaning reforms that do not abolish private property or markets, reforms that do not challenge the profit motive that led the fossil fuel industry to become so huge. The reformism of Compassionate Revolution was considered too radical to bring into Extinction Rebellion, and even the mildest criticisms some chapters have started to issue remain highly contentious, so I don't hold out much hope for them turning into social ecologists. Unfortunately, their attempts to remain apolitical have had some shitty repercussions, such as the prevalence of antinatalism within the movement, which borders on neo-Malthusianism, and Hunt Sabers being banned from their Facebook pages. Extinction Rebellion presents itself as a civil disobedience group inspired by the likes of Gandhi and Martin Luther King. So they're checking off the generic favourites everyone has a passing knowledge of. Here, the issue of XR's liberal ideology comes to the forefront. Cherry-picking two figures out of history, stripped of context both of what they were resisting and of the presence of other dissenters, and hoping the recognisability alone will endear the public to their tactics. Speaking of which... Extinction Rebellion places a peculiar emphasis on getting arrested. Their founder, Roger Hallam, explains as much in this oft-quoted clip.
The action itself is not actually that important. It's the going to prison, which has got cultural resonance, as you might say.
I've had discussions about the effectiveness of this tactic, whether or not getting people arrested creates effective change. In my opinion, no. Many of the actions done by past non-violent resistance movements weren't just attempts to get arrested, but a resistance to structures that they got arrested for. But Mugwump, lots of people are now talking about climate change thanks to XR. Oh good, I'm so glad we now know that climate change is an issue. We didn't really know before. Sorry, but we already knew climate change was an issue, and other activists have been drawing attention to it as well. So, after XR's actions in London, the UK government released a statement acknowledging climate change was an issue, and could they please pack it in? Congratulations, Extinction Rebellion, you've managed to make words speak louder than actions. Extinction Rebellion placed far too much trust in the state, not only to stop climate change, but also to be cooperative in their praxis. In its essence, this is peak liberalism. It is not a success story to have the state claim they will do something. Justin Trudeau promised Indigenous peoples that the construction of pipelines would be reviewed and their rights respected. He lied. The state collaborates with the fossil fuel industry over everything else. It cannot be trusted to put an end to these destructive forces, and that's all that this supposed rebellion is banking on. State promises. Even a cursory glance at the figures they claim to draw inspiration from, one can clearly see better implementation of non-violent tactics. An occupation of a space, for instance, is far more effective if what you're resisting is the state not letting you go where you want. Symbolically, the act is more poignant and less idiosyncratic because of the protest's direct relation to the injustice. The intention of these activists wasn't self-sacrifice and martyrdom. It was to resist an injustice, and their tactics, agree with them or not, were at least informed by what it was they were resisting. One could reasonably call it direct action. What Extinction Rebellion do are stunts. Their actions don't prevent anything. Extinction Rebellion are gambling that the state will shrink the fossil fuel industry if they can throw enough people into the prison industrial complex. Without a decent analysis of capitalism, they don't understand how their actions don't inconvenience the state, and their attempts to highlight the state's complicity in one sector of capitalist exploitation obscures its purpose in another.
The rest aren't happening quick enough. So, unfortunately, we need to find a number.
There was too many of you. And we may have run out of police officers at the minute, until we get some more police officers.
Insofar as their tactics go, I would say yes. To focus your praxis on getting arrested is incredibly detrimental to any struggle. It holds this air of romanticism about it. Getting arrested for what you believe, except they're not. It's not resistance, it's gift-wrapping the potential climate activists of the future for further prosecution and state surveillance. And so long as Extinction Rebellion choose to work with the police and feed their most dedicated members into the prison industrial complex, they'll never effectively challenge those who are protected by those institutions. And this is something that disturbs me on a broader scale, that Extinction Rebellion's cavalier attitude towards state repression could end up having wider repercussions, either through the expansion of the prison industrial complex and pushing the state to arrest more dissidents, or as a weak link within radical spaces. Even if you're not planning on getting arrested, it can still be dodgy attending their protests. In the past, they've circulated Section 14 of the Public Order Act, awareness of which makes it easier for the police to arrest you at a protest. Their tactics are even more dangerous for BAME and disabled people. BAME people statistically face worse repression in prisons and at the hands of the police. XR's handling of this so far has not moved beyond mere acknowledgement, like checking it off a list. With disabled activists, the concerns were only addressed internally, and many concerns, such as the police collaborating with the Department of Work and Pensions to sanction disabled activists, weren't given the proper attention and action needed to protect vulnerable people. Extinction Rebellion also claims to be a horizontal movement, but this is an easily falsifiable claim. I only need to point out the existence of paid members within the organisation.
So here's the deal, we're having a revolution,
yeah.
And we need people to work full time. What's your background work-wise?
Paid members have much more power within the organisation than regular members or volunteers. This is why anarchist organisations, with the exception of co-ops, which are smaller and pay everybody, do not have paid members. The roles are rotated. You might call this a compromise to make the movement larger and more efficient, which I would argue it doesn't necessarily do, but whatever compromises you think they're making, it doesn't mean that they haven't lied about their claims to horizontalism. Some members of XR have also claimed that there are more informal hierarchies within the organisation. Claims that one can only get propositions viewed depending on who they know within XR Central. XR Central could be a reference to the holding group. To quote from a sympathetic critique by Livera Planedo, Extinction Rebellion as an organization is controlled officially by a rising up, which is itself governed in a centralized hierarchical manner by a small group of people. This small group of people is called the holding group, and although anyone is technically eligible to become a member of it, its members have direct control over the membership of the holding group, causing the group to be a bureaucracy. As a result of being a bureaucracy, the holding group can be considered as contradictory to the principle of decentralization. But the contradiction that it creates within Extinction Rebellion is enhanced and made especially problematic by the power and control that the holding group has within Extinction Rebellion. The holding group decides what is officially part of Extinction Rebellion, and is thus able to exclude individuals and groups from the movement. In terms of funding, it doesn't get much better. Extinction Rebellion are uncritical of any capitalist willing to give them money for good publicity, regardless of whether or not they have stakes in major polluters or detention camps. It's also not clear to me how Rising Up acquired the capital for Extinction Rebellion to be established, but it's not an insignificant amount, some £30,000. I must emphasise, though, that I can't really make any accusations of astroturfing there, since I'm not an accountant and I've struggled to interpret those findings. Despite receiving large donations from suspect sources, though, XR does not pay the legal fees incurred by their careless tactics, instead trusting the local chapters to crowdsource legal funds. But you don't have to take it from me. You can take it from the Green and Black Cross, a grassroots group who provide legal support to activists. They've pulled their support for Extinction Rebellion and questioned the training they provide for their police liaisons. They've also criticised XR's data protection, much of their files being kept on open Google documents. You can take it from the activists who've been to prison and have spoken out about Extinction Rebellion's cavalier attitude to facing arrest. You can take a look at their now retracted prison survival guide and tell me if it seems like the people at the centre of this movement know what they're doing when it comes to handling state repression.
Wait. Take as many naps as you want. Plenty of good tips for yoga and meditation. What the fuck?
Extinction Rebellion's propaganda often refers to a study that claims non-violent resistance movements achieve their aims twice as often as violent ones, and once a movement reaches 3.5% of the population, it can successfully levy its demands. There is just one, or two, or three, or four problems with referencing this study. To start off with, the study is not applicable to the types of activism Extinction Rebellion is undertaking, that is to say, eco-activism. The study refers only to movements advocating for some kind of regime change. Sadly, Extinction Rebellion aren't looking to topple the state anytime soon, so this study is already moot in reference to their goals. The study is not even applicable to the civil rights movement of the 1960s. Something else that is notable is that the criteria for non-violent campaigns is incredibly faulty. To be considered a non-violent campaign within the dataset, there needs to be less than 1,000 deaths over the course of the campaign, meaning that the Weather Underground, who were a terrorist group that planted bombs in civic structures, would be classed as non-violent, seeing as only 3 people died over the course of their campaign. The study also uses geopolitics as a barometer of success. It claims that non-violent movements become more successful should a campaign gain support from military defectors or from foreign states. It glibly ignores the motivations of foreign state intervention and military defectors, assuming their concern must be humanitarian. The interests of imperialism are completely ignored. There are other issues with this study that are more complex, but I feel that I've touched upon the key issues with using this study in reference to Extinction Rebellion and their tactics. 1. But the campaigns included in the dataset had very different goals to Extinction Rebellion. 2. That the dataset for what is considered non-violent would make allowances for a lot of violence, such as riots, property damage, and even a limited number of deaths. 3. That the study claims non-violent campaigns are more successful because they can leverage foreign state intervention, which is simply outsourcing violence. Well, it is certainly easier to criticise than it is to be constructive, but I'll try to be. I won't lie, I am impressed by the numbers XR managed to pull in a short space of time. However, that's actually something that does concern me a bit. I wonder if the people joining en masse now are going to dwindle off once they see that the state are just going to keep making placating statements and increasing repression. Meanwhile, XR have no plans for escalation. If you know people in Extinction Rebellion, I'd at least try talking to them about ideas that tie environmentalism into things like state violence, imperialism, and private property. These issues all play into one another. Try talking to them about more radical figures from the movements XR claim to idolize, or emphasize how their praxis differs, and what worked. Turning them into anarchists or communists isn't really the point. You're going to disappoint yourself that way. At least get them to realise that one single fix isn't enough. Multiple issues need addressing. Also discourage them from getting arrested, because that's just really bad. As for a future environmentalist movement, fuck, I don't know. I can't tell you the merits of anti-civilization versus solar punk. All I can tell you is the problem of environmental decay is systemic. Capital and the state are at fault, and both need holding to account. Environmentalist movements lean overwhelmingly to the left, so generally they understand who they need to challenge. The constant need for capitalism's expansion is antithetical to an ecologically sustainable future. When it's on a local scale, you don't even need to be told that it's corporations and the state destroying the environment, because you can see them doing it firsthand. I guess that's my take on this, in a very anarchist fashion. Environmentalist groups need to tackle what's locally around them. Fracking companies, pipelines, refineries, factory farms, etc. That's where environmentalist groups can affect the most change. It's sadly also where the state is going to be a lot more repressive, and they won't have XR level money to bail you out and pay for defence. Not that XR used the money for that. And often the repression is physically violent, because that's where it hurts. Earlier this year, there were some shutdowns of coal mines done by Earth First and Reclaim the Power, with smaller groups of activists targeting the right places. They managed to halt mining operations, which, even though it's for a short period of time, cost these companies quite a lot of money, and if consistently sustained, it can cost the state and capitalists more than it's worth to run these sites. They may face state repression, but they don't invite it as XR do. However, we shouldn't write off Extinction Rebellion. There is something to be learned from how they've engaged people. I don't think people are inherently turned off by activism, especially with the amount of discontent we have in present society. XR made a huge splash by going around the country giving talks and signing people up, and pulling smaller events to amass support for their larger event. Of course, it helps to already have 30k in the bank in order to actually get this kind of publicity, but there might be something to learn from how they've mobilized for those first actions. I think what grabbed people's attention was the focus on a particular tactic, in this case nonviolent stunts. It drew a lot of attention and sympathy, and I think there might be a lesson to be learned from this. The general public respond to actions rather than ideas. If you're in Extinction Rebellion and you've made it this far without hitting dislike and leaving an angry screed in the comments, then thank you very much for hearing me out. I don't mean to tell you that everything I've committed myself to has been effective, but some things have been. What's often more effective is analysing your capacity and seeking out targets that match this capacity. From there, a movement might grow organically without the need for stunts or dodgy capitalist investors. I understand that for a lot of people, Extinction Rebellion is their first foray into activism, and for many this has been a positive experience. I can tell you why, because activism often creates an organic sense of community. Challenging that is often painful but necessary. I hope if there are people in XR watching this that I haven't come across as holding you in a callous disregard. I reserve that entirely for the likes of Hallam and Bradbrook, whom I see as dangerous opportunists. I hope there has been something learned from the repression Extinction Rebellion has faced lately, that the system doesn't bend to activist causes, it breaks them.